Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Big Daddy Top Hat here, ready to cover the history of a heavily requested game today, and one that was chosen by the fine people who back this channel on Patreon. In the past on here, we have already taken in-depth looks at all of the classic console and arcade beat-em-ups that were released in the golden age of the Turtles franchise. Hell, we even looked at the fighting games that were released around this time frame too. In each of these videos, when I have recapped the history of the games, I always mentioned the original home Turtles gaming experience, and briefly touch on how polarising this bloody game is. Throughout the noughties, this game came under heavy criticism from gamers after it was spotlighted in an extremely memorable episode of The Angry Nintendo Nerd that got many people talking about this game once more. This would surprisingly not be the last we saw of the game that decade, as we would receive a re-release of the title in the Nintendo Wii Shop in 2007. Whilst James Rolfe's review was mostly satirical in nature, IGN, GameSpot, Nintendo Life & Co. would completely bury the game in 2007, without a hint of humour or satire being present, further solidifying the title's reputation as a terrible game. Bringing all of this into account, why do I consistently see people pop up in my comment section insisting that Turtles is in fact a very good game? We need to get to the bottom of this, because on a surface level, none of this really makes any sense. So without further ado, this, ladies and gentlemen, is the mad story of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles for the NES, one of the most polarizing games of all time. Yeah. The year is 1989. For the past few years, Turtles Fever has been captivating the children of planet Earth. The popularity of the kids' animated TV show would of course lead to all sorts of other fantastic merchandising opportunities, with video games being among them. Japanese company Konami would be tasked with developing video games for both the arcade and home market. The 1989 four-player arcade game received universal praise and proved so popular that it would be scaled back and ported to home formats the following year. But prior to this, there was just one Turtles game that could be played at home, which was for its first year a Nintendo Entertainment System exclusive. Like the majority of the most popular games developed for the NES, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles would primarily function as a side-scrolling platform game, but would include a ton more additional mechanics, making the game a lot more complex than what else was available on the market at the time. Gameplay starts out allowing the player to take control of Leonardo, where the player can explore a Legend of Zelda-style top-down perspective overworld, and when the player enters buildings or sewers, players indulge in the game's core side-scrolling gameplay. Like in Mega Man, Castlevania and other side-scrollers, Leonardo has a health bar that depletes every time he collides with an enemy or projectile. He also has the ability to jump and swing his weapon to damage enemies. Stuff anyone would expect, really. Interestingly though, throughout the game, the player can switch a turtle out at will for another, each of which have their own independent life bars and unique weapons with varied reaches. On the NES, this style mechanic is heavily praised for its inclusion in the game, Little Samson. However, games such as Wonder Boy, The Dragon's Trap for the Master System, and this Turtles game are both early examples of this gameplay style. This mechanic means a player is only defeated by the game when all four turtles have been KO'd. The game follows the story of the turtles on a mission to retrieve the Life Transformer gun from Shredder, a device that could restore their Sensei Splinter back to his human form, but must rescue reporter April O'Neil along the way, disarm a series of bombs, as well as achieve a number of other feats on their way to their goal. Players must trek from location to location on the overworld screen, passing through side-scrolling sections, when in many cases there are specific objectives such as obtaining a specific item to progress or defeating a boss. Most stages though, the goal is simply to reach the exit. Along the way, to assist players, pizza can be picked up to restore health, and specific sub-weapons can be discovered and used against enemies. So I guess all in all, this is more than a simple platformer, as it manages to mix up all sorts of gameplay elements. Thus far, we have only obviously really talked about the game on a very surface level, and we shall dive in deeper soon. But first, let's see what journalists thought of the game when it first popped up in 1989. What were writers' impressions? Nintendo Power, in love with this game, stating, "The game is based on the characters created in Eastman and Laird's hit comic book of the same name, and will feature all of the fast action and crazy ninja tactics that you love in the comic book. One of the best things about this game is the superb play control in the action scenes and the super sharp graphics. The game machine said, initial playability is high. All the turtle sprites are well drawn and animated, and the bad guys present quite the challenge. Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles is a very playable slash 'em up. I just hope that whoever's producing the home computer version hurries up. The publication known as Raze would shower the game with praise too, with the amusing journalist putting forward, I'm not quite the person that all the Ninja Turtle hype is aimed at. I'm almost 61, you know. But even I had a great time playing the NES version of the Fab Four's Frolics. The difficulty factor is set just right, frustrating, but nothing to put your Nintendo in physical danger. The five action-packed levels are more than the average player can handle, but they just keep enticing you back for more. Computers and video games would highlight that the Turtles brand had become popular enough in Europe that Nintendo had decided to make the Turtles the packing game that came with the NES. After all, I guess that it did make sense considering the Turtles were hugely popular in Europe in 1990, whereas the NES itself had always failed to find a large audience. They would write, the Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles have certainly cowabungered their way into this issue with a vengeance. Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles really is a super cartridge, and what's more, it's now being given away free with the console itself. Extremely good value, both for those who buy it and those who get it for now. So, as you can see on this game's release, it was both a commercial and critical success, becoming one of the greatest selling games available on the NES. With the game being of a high enough quality to even impress adults, who did not give a crap about the children's animated show. So keeping all of this in mind, what went wrong that would change public perception regarding this game so drastically over the years? Let's go down this rabbit hole deeper. From what I can tell, looking at various sources on the information superhighway, on release many children found this game extremely difficult, and like with many other games of the period, would have to play it time and time again so that they could learn patterns and strategies to slowly get better at the game. People like myself who did not pick up this game until more recent years will be able to confirm how hard this game is simply to pick up and play. You will die time and time again very quickly, simply by not knowing what is coming next. There are so many ways to be picked off fast, including by being literally steamrolled as soon as you press start to play. This is a game you have to get good at and learn how to deal with problems in order to make any significant progress with. To be fair, everything I've just mentioned are tropes of the majority of home console games developed in the 1980s. So why did this game quickly attract an extra layer of salt from some people? Well, there are a few factors that contributed to this, before the game's re-emergence in the mid-2000s. Firstly, this was a game aimed at young children, and many found the mechanics involved with this game either confusing or even a bit broken, which we shall be discussing more on very shortly. Secondly, from everything I have been able to learn online, many children were unhappy with the selection of characters included in the game, such as a lot of kids were disappointed with the lack of the inclusion of Krang, one of the main antagonists from the animated TV show. What many small children would not have realised at the time though is that there was more to the Turtles brand than the cartoon they watched on TV, and that was only one telling of the story. Turtles was first a comic book series that began being published in 1984, 3 entire years before an animated show was even introduced. If you look at the game's box art, the art style used reflects the Turtles' depiction from the original comic book, rather than the TV show, displaying each of the Turtles with the same red-coloured eye bandanas. The link to the comic books further explains Krang's lack of inclusion, as he was an additional character simply made up of the TV show, who was initially not included in the real Turtle source material. So at first, where it may look like the developers were out of touch, no, the children were wrong. Weirdly though, this only seems to be partly the case. For example, once you actually start playing the game, the Turtles feature the same coloured eye bandanas that they had in the cartoon. You will also notice that Rocksteady and Bebop are bosses in the game. Like Krang, both characters were designed specifically for the kids' show. All of these characters would later appear in the Archie comics, a separate comic book series where they appeared in 1987. However, Krang would not appear in it until December. So with one TV show and two comic books, there were three different Turtle canons all around simultaneously. And it seems that the game is mainly based off the original comic, with maybe a few cartoon show elements implemented into the game, such as the bandanas in the late stages. But obviously, this is just conjecture at this point. Either way, no Krang in the game certainly annoyed many children who loved the cartoon, the only turtles in their tiny minds. So there were a couple of reasons some people who grew up with the game would have been less fond of it than others, despite the game receiving a lot of very good reviews at launch. Many years later, on June 21st, 2006, episode 5 of a show known as The Angry Nintendo Nerd would surface online, which took a satirical look at the by then 17 years old Turtles NES game. The nerd would ridicule the game, referring to it as the most annoying game he had ever played, and stated the game was so bad that it sucks ass from a straw. In this amusing video, he would criticise many of the game's elements, even highlighting many particular moments that he deemed very annoying. From the characters beeping when they had low health, to the fact that Donatello was the only turtle worth playing as due to his superior reach. He acknowledges how easy it is to die in the game, including the steamroller on the overworld map I mentioned earlier. The video is basically 7 straight minutes of poking fun at the game, basically everything you would want in an episode from the man. There are a few famous scenes in the video which everyone remembers in relation to both this video and the Turtles game, including the game's water sections where you have to pass through the electrified weeds with a time limit, sections of the game where it appears to have convoluted jumps, the inaccessible pizza, and the part where you can just walk over it. Even the lack of Krang will be brought up in this video too, so this is a classic episode in James Rolfe's series that would act as a strong catalyst in the building of his own popularity. But it certainly did not do the 1989 Konami game any favours in terms of its reputation when it comes to its quality. As mentioned at the beginning of this video, this would not be the only time the game would be relevant in the noughties, as 2007 would see the game re-released in the Wii Shop, so anybody could purchase this game and add it to their collection once more. But as already stated earlier, journalists would tear this game a new arsehole. Looking at some of these reviews from 2007, a lot of the complaints brought forward seem strikingly similar to those raised in the Nintendo Nerd satirical content. Nintendo Life would start their review by stating, "Turtle Mania was sweeping the world when this came out in 1989. That's probably why this game was so popular, despite it being an unfair bag of dog's droppings. The comparison to actual fecal matter sounds like the words of the nerd himself here, so his influence becomes immediately present." They would also echo that most of the turtles are not worth playing as due to their poor reach, and would claim the game was only ever popular due to the turtles' branding and nothing else, which is amusing in contrast to all of the launch reviews I have read from adults who had never watched the Turtles cartoon. Like the nerd, they would state that one slight mess up and you have to backtrack several screens, taking more and more damage. This just doesn't work in a game of this nature, it adds to the frustration factor. They would conclude with, "Don't let childhood nostalgia blind you to the flaws this game has. By all means, if you have fond memories of this from when you were a kid, download it, but don't say we didn't warn you." Unlike the Nintendo Life reviewer, the IGN writer who reviewed the game claims to have had the game in his own childhood, admitting to highly enjoying the game back then, but he too does complain that he was never happy with the lack of characters from the TV show in the game, which brings us back to the Krang obsession once again, I guess. Like the nerd and Nintendo Life, he also writes that Leonardo's katana blade and Donatello's bow are the only truly effective weapons in the game, and more often than not, you will find yourself exploring the map with Michelangelo and Raphael simply because they are more dispensable. The IGN journalist concludes his piece with, "I probably sound like a turtle hater. I actually really enjoyed this game as a kid, and even made it to the end, but upon revisiting the game over a decade later, it becomes increasingly apparent that the game is inherently flawed and simply doesn't stand the test of time." GameSpot, like other sources in 2007, would hate the game too, commenting that they felt it was absolutely insane that Konami had the audacity to charge $6 to play an old NES game. but their general criticisms of the game would mainly fall in line with others from that year. From all of this, I have to say the drastic shift between 1989 to 2007 from journalists thinking the game is amazing to in the future thinking it's absolutely dreadful is a ridiculous shift in opinion. Sure, you would expect people to see the holes in a game as it ages, like we often do with GoldenEye and Mario 64 today, for example. But no one ever claims that these games are actually awful. It is generally acknowledged that they were amazing in their time, but rough around the edges today. I am surprised that journalists chose to give Turtles no slack whatsoever, and it makes me wonder how influenced they possibly would have been by James Rolfe's satirical work a year earlier. It is certainly an interesting scenario, because I cannot think of such a drastic change in opinion when it comes to many other games. For years past this point, to some degree, I would say the internet hive mind thought of a Turtles game as a badly programmed title that people only got enjoyment out of because it had the Turtles in it, and still liked it out of nostalgia. Whenever I brought up this game's poor reception in a video, I would always get people turn up and defend it. As recent as December last year, the Cinemassacre channel would release a brand new video on the game, one of which addressed how the game had been portrayed in that famous episode back in 2006. Mike Mattai, who has always helped work on the Nerd series, mentions that he is sick of going around conventions defending the quality of the first Turtles game, a title that he feels he played a role in sullying the reputation of, due to helping produce that classic satirical video. He points out that the angry video game nerd is just a comedy show, and the game reviews are just a joke, even if some legitimate points are laced in between the content. This new video is an interesting 36-minute discussion on the game, breaking down many of the jokes and criticisms included in the original Nerd video, and illustrating why if you was to review the game in a serious manner, that the criticism would simply not be fair. Like myself today, he addresses the game being an amalgamation of the comic book and the cartoon series, hence why it does not follow the canon of the TV show exactly, which is a criticism that is always brought up. He also attempts to debunk the Michelangelo and Raphael in the game both sucking, commenting that both the characters have the ability to one-hit certain enemies, and that switching between the Turtles is about more than just Donatello's superior reach, which from my own personal research is not something 2007 journalists managed to get their heads around. Addressing some of the more famous moments in the Nerd episode, such as the unreachable pizza, sewer jump, and part in the warehouse where you had to just walk over it, they were all examples of good game programming, educating the player on the game's mechanics and nuances. The pizza was placed in an obviously unreachable place to encourage the player to run away from the jaws of life as quick as possible, and that the sewer jumping section and the warehouse walk over it bit taught players how to deal with certain obstacles in low risk environments where bad footing would not kill them, allowing them to utilise these same skills later on in a playthrough. The same goes for the steamroller one-hit KO at the beginning too, as it does not matter if you die as soon as you begin, as you can reset, but at least you know how dangerous the steamrollers actually are. He also brings up that if a player puts time into practicing the game, that they will get better and learn the quickest route when dealing with the game's often criticised water section with the electrified plants. In my personal opinion, these plants are so hard to avoid as the programmers want players to use the turtle switching mechanic to further ensure players know how to effectively use that function. In terms of this difficult section, YouTuber John Riggs recently showed me an amusing video where he managed to swim through this treacherous section, but to do it he had to start from the same emulated save point an insane amount of times before he finally got there, even illustrating a trick to stop the flow of the current in the process. Now, when it comes to the game's outrageous difficulty, Mattai acknowledges that like many games of the era, it's about repetition, building knowledge and fast reflexes. However, there are also simple tricks you can pick up that make the experience far less challenging than many of the 2000 journalists tried to claim. On the surface, the ability to switch characters is clearly an important skill when it comes to getting through this game, but knowing which turtles are best to use against certain enemies and maximising the use of sub-weapons such as boomerangs can also make the experience easier. More importantly, it seems that many people fail to pick up that the game is fairly easy to recover in when losing health, because you can consume pizza infinite times provided you exit and re-enter the room. It is not just a case of only enemies being able to respawn, like some would have you believe. Further to this, there is also a way of reviving KO Turtles 2, which not all gamers are aware of. Basically, buildings are located off the beaten track on the overworld map, where you can claim your fallen allies back, making the experience slightly easier. Regardless of any criticisms, there is no doubt that for a game from 1989, that Turtles has more depth than most of its platforming contemporaries from the era. But this same complexity may have proved to be too much of a barrier for many people to even bother properly with the game, despite it having some of the most captivating music to complement this adventure available on NES hardware. In 2020, like many things, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles for the NES is a polarizing game, with people often holding vastly different opinions with regards to this title's quality. In 1989, the game was beloved. In 2006 and 2007, the game was hated. And in 2020, I guess we have perhaps finally reached some sort of middle ground, which is probably the wisest position to be in with regards to this game. But at the end of the day, it's all a matter of opinion, I suppose, but I hope at the very least this video gives you a little bit of historical context with regards to how many of these opinions were formed. Anyway, I'd love to hear your thoughts on this game below. So, ladies and gentlemen, that was the mad story of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles for the NES. If you are new to my channel, why not subscribe for in-depth videos like this covering gaming history every week? And if you are really hardcore, why not back this channel for $5 a month on Patreon to receive exclusive access to my patron-only documentaries? This week, I look at the often misunderstood Atari 5200. So why not check it out? Speaking of patrons, huge shoutouts go out to Sebastian Velez, Carl Johnson, A Murder of Crows, Heo Paulo Lopez, Joseph Rasmick, Luke Samuel Denton, Corey I. Marsh Sr., Capcom vs. SNK, BXL Gotham, Rowan Dinched, Evan Balder, Philip Manth, Cambo Rambo 82, Azrael Rorikai, Keith Ferguson, Joaquin Varela, Prince Knight, Michael Cullix, Ago, Jordan Durant, Angel Light 85, Alephia Swanson, Timothy W. Haskins II, Nick Daniels, Princess Zana, Glenny Glenn, Daniel Daly, Computer Man, House of the Ted, Gary Pinkett, ECU Professor, Kid Anime, Justin Wang, Aaron McNamara, Instant Gratification Monkey, Man Shovel, James Bishop, JB, Post DXL, Michael Hall, Wesley Sankey, Dwayne Pipe, Langston Miller, Noob, Brian Barry, Stephen Lewis, Sarah Powell, Vlay Mink Renee, Marvin Araliga, Chris Cool, TOG Driver, Adrian Hannington, Bernard NG, Richard Stew, Stuart, James McDonald, Crazy Yarl, Dan Van Dammit, Adam Castin, Lewis Viant, John Bates, David Bow, Chris Fisk, Paul Elliott, Mean Machine Dean, Mike Bruno, Rick67, Antonio Rodriguez, Hans Christian, Craig Jenkins, Tom Elliott, Retroverse.com, Casey Wright, Sin Spaces, Zai, Andrew Bazansky, Gunther Hendrix. I would like to thank each and every one of you so bloody much for continuing to support this very niche channel. Yeah! It's all for you. Cheerio.